I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House here in North Minneapolis. And you know, it's all about the neighborhood. This is a conversation about how we build our community, our neighborhood, house by house, family by family. We're focusing on business creation, business development, economic development, and culture. It's a wonderful conversation, a robust conversation. One of the guides for this conversation is my brother, who takes us on a musical journey, Wayne McFarlane and jazz. Check him out.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here, be wherever, be sour, be sweet, be the rhythm, be the beat, be funny, be serious, be in, be out, wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Programming is supported by UCare, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCare. Healthcare that starts with you.
I'm Al McFarland. Welcome to Conversations with Al McFarland. I'm pleased to have as my guest today Councilmember Blong Yang. He represents the 5th Ward in the city of Minneapolis. Blong, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
This is a trying time for the 5th Ward, for North Minneapolis. Your district, your ward, my ward, we're in 5th Ward right now. I live in the neighborhood, you do as well. But we have been beset by a series of events that have the community, you could say, upset and or divided about some issues around the shooting death of Jamar Clark. I'm going to ask you from the point of view of an elected official, describe the sequence of activities. What happened and how do we get here?
Well, what happened was, on a night, a little bit after Saturday, a shooting happened. It was an officer-involved shooting that involved two officers and a gentleman by the name of Jamar Clark. I think in a lot of ways, people forget what the things that led to that incident. And maybe that's not relevant at this point, but in that officer-involved shooting, an African-American gentleman died, and the next day, we had folks who came to protest, at the 5th Ward on Plymouth Avenue near the 4th Precinct. And it was, pretty much on Plymouth Avenue all the way to Penn Avenue, just kind of the sort of protest that, you would just think, would be something that would happen, on an evening, and then people would go home, and then it became this sort of occupation in which folks just stayed, at the 4th Precinct, and they, created this encampment with tents and fire pits and all that stuff blocking Plymouth Avenue for, about at least a block, if not more. And, it's gone on. This is what, day 17 of the occupation, as if you will. And, in some ways, the protesters have made some demands. And, of the demands, initially there were 5 demands. Eventually, it just became innumerable. I just can't count it anymore at this point. But of the 5 initial demands, two of them were met. There was a request for a federal investigation. That happened in light speed, in government talk. That just happened almost overnight. And a couple of days later, officers' names were released along with their profiles. And those are the 2 things that could be done. The other 3 things that were asked of, in terms of releasing the videos, there are laws in place that don't allow that. Also, this investigation has gone on to the state and federal levels, and so both of those entities would have to consent to allow those tapes to be released. Minneapolis, as a city, does not have any authority over that. There was a request for us to move to residency requirements for police officers. Well, there's a law in place that says you can't have that. There is, another request for a civilian review authority in which basically, you would have, a civilian review authority that looks over police misconduct. Well, Civilian Review Authority was axed about 3 years ago, and you know, in some ways, it was caused because of a law that you know got passed at the state level that basically said CRAs cannot do findings of fact, and so you would have to change state law to be able to create a CRA that you know had subpoena power along with disciplinary power. You know, the disciplinary power piece. I mean, you know, it rests with the chief and the mayor, and you know that's. You know, by charter, I mean, something that would be very difficult to get out of those two hands. So, I mean, those sorts of things, you know, have happened. You know, I've heard other demands as well in terms of, you know, putting Minneapolis Police Department under federal receivership. Well, I can tell you, I mean, to do that would basically mean that we have failed as city leadership. And I would say even the most liberal of city council members would probably squirm at that. You know, so I mean, there's that. I mean, there's just a number of different things that have been thrown out there. You know, firing the two officers right now. You know, we just can't do that because of collective bargaining agreements and things like that. And so, I mean, it's just, you know, in some ways, I mean, I feel like it's just gotten nutty and crazy. And, you know, it's not reasonable anymore. And it has just gotten to the point where, you know, it defies logic.
Let's review kind of the range of comments you've gotten from people that are passionately supportive of the action of those people who are protesting on Plymouth Avenue, and of those who may be, you know, put off by it and who feel that the protesters don't have the right to take the stand they're taking over a prolonged period of time. What are you hearing? What's the spectrum from A to Z?
Well, yeah, you know, there has been a huge spectrum.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, on the Black Lives Matter side, which is, you know, on the one side, I mean, it's just this, you know, council member, you know, you're a person of color, you don't care about people of color, you don't care about black people, that's just kind of the way you are, and that's why you're just perpetuating this white supremacy that happens at City Hall. You know, on the other side, folks are just saying, open up Plymouth Avenue. You know, we want our lives to become normal again. We want access to police departments or the precinct. We want the things that, you know, other people would want, and why would you do it in North Minneapolis? Why wouldn't you do it somewhere else? You know, and I think, I mean, all those, you know, views are out there, certainly, but, I mean, you know, I'll tell you, I didn't go to City Hall to be the man to, you know, I mean, perpetuate white supremacy. I mean, I went there to do some good work and to help people of color, and, you know, that's what I feel like I'm slowly moving towards, but, you know, government, it does not move as fast as we all want it to. I mean, I think most of us wanted racial equity yesterday. And, you know, I look at, you know.
And we should.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely, we should. But, I mean, I think that's the thing, is that it's a slow process, and it's a process that is going to take, you know, some massaging. It's going to take a bit of time. And, you know, it, where we would need to get to may not happen in your lifetime or my lifetime. But, you know, I mean, we always want to continue the struggle and move. And, you know, I think there's a way to do it where we can move together. There's a way to do it where, you know, we can just, you know, occupy the fourth precinct and not allow the folks in North Minneapolis to have access to their police department.
One of the critical areas was video. And so I'm presuming that the demand that's being presented is people are looking for copies of official, maybe the ambulance or police cruiser video. But wasn't there video from other residents? I don't know the answer to this, but I'm asking you. And has that been available or presented on Facebook or anything? Do you know?
You know, I would say this, you know, in terms of video that is, let's say, from private citizens, I would say if it was there, it'd be out on Facebook already.
It probably isn't.
You know, and I think, I mean, you know, in terms of thinking about it, I mean, there probably isn't. And, you know, or even if there was, you know, we haven't seen it surface. You know, the video that we've seen surface on Facebook, I mean, it was a video that was taken after the shooting. It wasn't, you know, a video that, you know, got the play-by-play from, you know, the start of the incident all the way to the end.
Okay. So what do you envision as the outcome of this? Right now, people are still up in arms and divided, but sentiments are changing by the day, I sense. I think there's this great and passionate support for the cause of police accountability. People raise the question, and they should, about use of force and whether or not certain levels of force are justified. And that's a fair question. It should always be raised. People are demanding accountability. They should. And the city and government have to be responsive and accountable, I think. Transparency is a critical factor. Where do you see us going? How do we put those ideals to test, or how does the situation put those principles to test?
Well, let me first address the protests. You know, I hope eventually, and maybe sooner rather than later, that folks go home, that it gets dispersed, that the 4th Precinct opens up and, you know, operates as normal. You know, I imagine, you know, we're going to have to do an assessment of the cost, the damage that, you know, was done to the 4th Precinct, that was done to the area around it, and we're going to have to just figure that part out. You know, with regards to, you know, where we're moving as a police department, you know, as chair of public safety, you know, in some ways, I mean, let me just explain city government really quickly. You know, the mayor actually has direct oversight over the police department. The city council, you know, writes the checks, basically. So the police department wants to spend on stuff. The city council is the one that looks over the spending. But, you know, we don't have direct control over what happens, tactics at the police department. But, you know, with regards to how we're moving, I feel like we're moving in the right direction, you know, with a couple of things. You know, one is, you know, we're participating in the Office of Justice programs, and we're looking at our police department and looking at ways to improve the police department so that we can have a police department that is, you know, for right now, basically. You know, so that's one part. I mean, I think the other part is, you know, we're engaging in a national initiative to look at our police department and see what we can do in terms of racial reconciliation, you know, how to engage community and those sorts of things. And, you know, it's, again, like anything else, I'll tell you, I mean, I'm impatient, and I know the processes are long, and I know that folks out there are very impatient as well. And, you know, these processes will take some time, but I feel like we're moving in the right place. You know, in about March of 2016, I mean, we will roll out the body cam program. And, you know, initially, I think the police department, you know, had, you know, a schedule as to, you know, what precincts would go first. I'm kind of going to guess that the 4th Precinct might be at the top of the list now. Yeah. So, I mean, it's those sorts of things that are happening, and it's, again, it's slow, but it's going to happen. You know, I would just say, you know, folks should go home, and, you know, I think, I mean, gear up for, you know, when the evidence gets, or gets, is given to the prosecutor, you know, at Hennepin County, and then at that point, or when the case goes to the grand jury, maybe we should be ready for the results at that point. But, you know, I think, I mean, that's the thing, is that, you know, we can't just have one way of looking at, you know, what the results are. I mean, we should just be very open to, you know, whatever's going to happen, because, you know, I mean, for myself, like, I don't know what happened. I wasn't there, and I'm not casting judgments on any of that stuff. I just think that the process will take care of itself.
What does an incident like this do for the residents of the community? Let me phrase that this way. Several levels. At the big level, we've got national press, and it sort of, again, puts a negative light on our police department. It highlights the tension between police and community. Not everybody, but the black community in particular. Two, we're in a community that is seeking redevelopment and development that has had challenges. I think a lot of good things are happening here. How does this affect them? Three, but at the very small level, I wonder about the reports I saw of a 10-year-old child who newscasts say witnessed the shooting. I'm wondering about the trauma this child is experiencing, the trauma that the other bystanders may experiencing for having witnessed the incident, and the trauma the officers are experiencing as well. What does our city do? What is our obligation to look at and respond to the, I guess it's the collateral damage or consequences of this problem, this issue? What do you think?
Well, you know, in terms of the trauma related to the 10-year-old child, and, you know, for other folks involved, it's my understanding that a request was made by Black Lives Matter to City of Minneapolis, the mayor specifically, with regards to providing grief counseling, and that's been provided for. You know, I don't know the details of that, but I can assure you that that has been done, at least from the mayor's perspective. With regards to the officers, I mean, I think there are supports in place, you know, with the police department to provide for them as well. You know, I think, I mean, as a community, though, I mean, there is that trauma for the whole community, and yeah. You know, that's very real.
And it's not really about just this incident,
that's
because we've got
other
people being killed by other people, it seems like, all the time. Maybe it's not as much as I think it is, but every time. It's horrific.
Right.
So how do we deal with that?
You know, I think, you know, as a community, I mean, you know, one, we need to figure out what we want to do, you know, in terms of the solutions. But I also say, you know, as city leadership, I mean, we have to take a deep, long look at, you know, what our processes are and how we change it to make it better so that people will have faith. Because at the end of the day, I mean, it's about public faith in government. You know, whether it's public faith in the police department or the city council or the mayor, it's just that is most critical to how we move forward. And, you know, so I think for us, I mean, at some point, we're going to have to gather ourselves and figure out what we do next to, you know, make it better for the city of Minneapolis that we're moving to the right place. But, you know, I'll tell you, you know, when I ran for office, I mean, you know, it was something that was definitely under the surface. You know, this sort of strong and deep and historic mistrust of the police department. And, you know, I understand it. I think it's real. And I think, you know, in a lot of ways, I mean, I feel like at the city, I mean, we are working our butts off to, you know, get to a better place. But, you know, I think a lot of times, I mean, it just seems like, you know, every step we're taking, I mean, we're taking two steps back. But, you know, I'm telling you, we are trying and we're moving forward as much as we can.
Well, so, but the thing is complicated by the fact that the national news reports what happened in Chicago.
Right.
I mean,
oh, yeah,
in the middle of what we're doing here, right, we get the story of police misconduct in, right, Chicago, protests like the ones we're having here in Chicago. We've had Ferguson, we've had Baltimore. And so the point is that these claims of discrimination and prejudice have been made consistently over a long period of time. They've been consistently ignored, people marginalized, and even people vilified for daring to challenge the establishment, city government. And what's being revealed now is the truth of the pattern of discriminatory public policy. How does that make your job?
It makes it hard. Yeah. It makes it very difficult because, you know, I mean, now, I think there are so many problems up here on the north side that we can be figuring out. And, you know, this is the big problem, though. Mm-hmm. And this is the big elephant in the room that we have to tackle. And so, you know, I feel like at some point, I mean, we need to start slowly peeling away at that and fixing that. And, you know, I mean, I'll tell you, you know, this year, I mean, we just did a repeal of the spitting and lurking ordinance. And that's a small little step. I mean, to the big problem that you're talking about, I mean, we need to put all of our energy into trying to figure out where we go with that to make it better. And so, you know, I would say, I mean, that's the part that is going to be difficult to, you know, move forward on. And, you know, if people have great ideas, I mean, please, my office is available and, you know, give me a call because I really want, you know, us to move to a better direction than where we are, because you're absolutely right. I mean, all these things, it's, you know, I think, I mean, in some ways, you know, if as city government, we've treated it as, you know, rumor, innuendos, and all of a sudden, you know, they become this big problem. I mean, we got to unravel and fix it.
Mm-hmm. Blong, let me take a break now, and we'll come back and continue. You know, I don't want to be focused on all the negative and other problems. I think that there is a great and bright ray of hope for North Minneapolis. I think we're at a turning point, and I want to have this conversation go towards what you see as the positives, the things that mean the community will build, rebuild, and move towards the greatness it ought to be experiencing. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. We'll be back in a minute. I'm Al McFarlane. Welcome back to Conversations with Al McFarlane, broadcasting from the Marcus Garvey House in North Minneapolis. It's my pleasure to have 5th Ward Councilmember Blong Yang, a great conversation about the challenges in North Minneapolis, the challenges in an ethnically diverse community. And I think we're going to talk about the potential. The challenges also mean there's potential, there are opportunities. The word, you know, the vocabulary of the day is about disparities. North Minneapolis, the black community in Minnesota, experience huge gaps of outcomes, health, housing and wealth, homeownership and wealth, education outcomes, jobs, employment. And so we've got a lot of problems. And sometimes it seems we spend so much time categorizing and studying and organizing around the problems, and not enough time looking at the solution side of the equation. I hope that our community will begin to see itself as a problem-solving community and present itself as a partner in fixing families and neighborhoods. But that implies that the leadership of the city is both supportive and responsive. What do you think about that? Is the city responsive to ordinary neighborhood people, to black people who say they want to build a vibrant and responsive, responsible community? What do you think?
Oh, we are absolutely in the game on that. We need to be. And you know, I think the longer we allow these disparities to happen, the more costly it will be for us to jump in at a later date. And so, you know, I feel like, you know, we should be all in at this point to figure out what we need to do. You know, and you know, whether it's housing, whether it's jobs, whether it's businesses on West Broadway, we got to figure that stuff out. Because, you know, when you look at, let's just say, West Broadway, I mean, you know, I mean, there are days where I wish that black folks, Hmong folks, you know, Latinos, Somalis come to my office and say, you know, we have a great idea and we have all this capital and we want to build on West Broadway. That rarely ever happens. You know, and so as a city, I mean, we need to figure out how we get black folks, Hmong folks, and other folks to get on West Broadway.
So have we communicated that to them?
You know, I would like to think that I have, but I mean, you know, I
haven't heard it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, here it is.
Here it is. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know,
my point is, I think there has to be, if that's the intent and the desire, there has to be a very intentional and massive communication effort to make sure that that message is there, so that people begin to internalize it and to adopt a mindset in the community that says, here is opportunity and now is opportunity. What do you think?
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, in terms of, you know, our outreach to the general community about, you know, the opportunities that are at the city, you know, we have not done a good enough job. You know, I think on the other hand, I mean, you know, what tends to happen is that when we do a good enough job and people come, you know, our systems are in place and they make it very difficult for the typical average person to, you know, get through city government, get through the bureaucracy and get to doing a business. And so, I mean, all of our processes are in some ways, I mean, geared towards somebody who's, you know, highly educated, you know, who has cash and those sorts of things. And so, I mean, we have to rethink how we do things so that the average person who has a couple of bucks but has a great idea gets in the same position. And I think that's a part that city government has not tried to figure out very well yet. But, I mean, that's something that we need to do. Because, you know, you look at a lot of these minority businesses that are on West Broadway, Lowry, and other places, and they basically bring their life savings in a prayer, and they hope that it works. You know, you look at other businesses that have been successful. I mean, some businesses, they get pretty nice subsidies to start. I mean, anywhere from 5 to 10 to 20 to 50% to start their businesses. And so when they lose, you know, as generally people say, you know, small businesses tend to fail more than half of the times. Well, when they fail, they don't lose their whole life savings. Whereas, you know, if you're a minority and you're starting your own business with your life savings, and if you lose everything.
You really lose.
Yeah,
that's a problem. So do you have any ideas to simplify the process? What would you do?
You know, I just think that, you know, we need to hold people's hands. I mean, that's one thing that, you know, I've committed to, you know, with my office is, you know, if somebody wants to put something on West Broadway, I mean, we will hold their hands to, you know, get through the processes if needed. You know, I think that, you know, in terms of, you know, these grants or these loan opportunities, I mean, I think we need to make it simpler so that, you know, people get, you know, how to navigate through the processes to receive a grant or a loan. I mean, those sorts of things are things that we need to make much, much easier for the average person. And, you know, in some ways, I like to say it like this. I mean, in terms of our application processes, we need to make it so that, you know, a high school senior can do it. And if we can do that, I mean, it's going to make it a lot easier for, you know, the folks up here to be able to access government.
So do you think that people simply are not responsive because they don't want to be or because they don't know about it or they're not capable? What's been the reason we haven't had the response from the community?
You know, I think it's all of those things. And on top of that, it's this idea that, I mean, for a person of color who is trying to, you know, get into business, I mean, their biggest hurdle is the capital. Capital makes it that much more difficult for them. And so, you know, how do we do it so that we can get them into, you know, let's say a build on West Broadway? Well, you know, look, I mean, if you're going to build a building on West Broadway, I mean, you know, any of the buildings that you're seeing built on West Broadway, I mean, it's going to be in the millions of dollars. That's so far away from most regular folks, even including myself. And so that's the part that just says, you know, most folks is, no, I can't do it.
Yeah. Let's talk about West Broadway. You and I were at a meeting a couple of days ago. Right. You and other leaders talked about the opening, the groundbreaking for the return of the former Ford building to productive use, a new workforce center for the state. And it's a unique partnership that involves not only the state workforce program, but also, I believe, Minneapolis Community College, right. And also North Point Health and Wellness. Right. And it'll be a facility that has retail. Right. Talk about that. What's going to happen there?
Right. And it also includes Minneapolis Public Schools. And right. So, you know, it's, yeah. You know, it's this idea of, you know, helping folks to get to a job, helping folks to get to a career, you know, while also, you know, being a critical part of West Broadway. The retail there, I think there's going to be about 6,000 square feet there of retail. I don't know what's going to go in there, you know, at this point, but, you know, I mean, in a lot of ways, it will be a catalyst for other developments that could happen, you know, right across the street. I mean, the old White Castle site is empty, and it was bought recently, but still, you know, this idea of, like, what do we need to put on West Broadway to really enliven it and bring it back to, you know, it's heyday. I wasn't born then, I have to tell you, but...
I was around.
Okay.
I started Insight back in 1974, I think, and at that time, the second cover of the Insight magazine included the executive team for the West Broadway Business Association. So the organization was there, it was vibrant. The avenue was getting ready to go into massive change, and the change has happened. And so, but the memory of a vibrant, family-oriented community is there. So the question is, how do we revive that in its modern form? Yeah.
You know, and I think, I mean, what needs to happen is that we need to help small businesses to grow on West Broadway, and we need to, you know, empower or, you know, give faith to people who live up here to rebuild on West Broadway. You know, and I know that's going to take millions and millions of dollars, but I mean, we need to figure out a way of doing that so that, you know, we're not waiting for the big boxes to come and save West Broadway. I mean, we can save ourselves, and I think we have a lot of talent and skills in this community, and we need to, you know, I mean, give people a boost or encourage them to get onto West Broadway.
Is population density a problem in North Minneapolis? It seems like we've got a wasteland. We don't have the density of people that Uptown has.
I'll tell you, I don't agree with that.
Okay.
You know, I mean, you look at West Broadway within the context of North Minneapolis, we have 70,000 people in North Minneapolis. I mean, you look at a small city like Arden Hills, and, you know, I mean, it's, what, 23,000 or so, and they have, you know, all these shopping areas around it. And, you know, and so people would say, you know, why Arden Hills and why not North Minneapolis? Well, Arden Hills supposedly has, you know, more disposable income and those sorts of things. But, I mean, I don't think that explains why there's a wasteland, as you call it, here. I mean, I think people here have money. Mm-hmm. You know, whether they're poor or rich, they have money. They need to buy essentials, and they can buy essentials here. The problem is that they don't buy essentials here. I mean, they spend a lot of money outside of here, and so we need to create, you know, a community that actually, you know, absorbs all that money here and keeps it here. And so we need to do, you know, different things and envision a different North Minneapolis that allows for people to spend their money here. You know, you look at the Smalley population that is here in North Minneapolis, you know, I mean, in the couple of thousands, guess where they spend their money? South Minneapolis. You look at this Hmong population that lives here, I mean, guess where they spend their money? St. Paul, Brooklyn Center, Brooklyn Park, not here in North Minneapolis as much as they should. And I mean, we're losing all that money.
Community.
Absolutely.
Spans downtown or
absolutely.
Brooklyn Center, Brooklyn Park,
right.
Somewhere, but
right.
Not here.
Right, and so that's our issue, is that we're losing all that money, and that money can be here. Mm-hmm. So we need to, you know, re-envision how we want to build this community here with retail, with all these vibrant things that are here that people want to stay here. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And so, you know, when I talked about the wasteland, I partly talked about the reality of lots of boarded and vacant houses. That's a problem.
Right.
What do you do about that?
Well, you know, so I'll give you some numbers really quickly. You know, in the city of Minneapolis, we have 500 plus boarded and vacant homes. Mm-hmm. In terms of vacant lots, mm-hmm. we have over 700.
Okay.
In North Minneapolis, of those numbers in North Minneapolis, I mean, we have over 200 boarded and vacant homes on the north side alone. You know, in terms of vacant lots, I mean, I think we have almost the same, if not more, vacant lots up here. And, you know, there was a story right before the Jamar Clark shooting where, you know, it was talking about, you know, how the city is trying to move to get to a place where we are addressing these issues up here on the north side, especially because, you know, to me, I mean, when you look at this deficit of having, you know, boarded and vacant homes and boarded and vacant or vacant lots, I mean, to me, I see opportunity. How do we move people of color into these homes? How do we get them to own these homes? You know, and you know, when you look at the model, I mean, basically, it's a fairly simple model. It's just, you know, I mean, on the city side, sometimes we sell houses for about a dollar, if not, you know, a couple thousand dollars, depending on the quality. Yeah. And you know, we sell it to folks who want to rehab the places. Well, that's where the problem lies. I mean, the folks who tend to want to rehab the places, they have capital or they have cash. Yep. The folks who don't, I mean, they tend to be like us, right? Right.
And they can get it done. And right. People who are here, who are renters, that would make the community maintain its diversity, don't have access to the money or the credit.
Right, and that's our problem as a city, in my view. I mean, we need to figure out how we do it so that we can get money or credit into the hands of people of color to get into these homes. And I think that's the thing, is that, you know, when you look at the market, I mean, I'll just do a simple math for you. I mean, if you buy a house for a dollar, you put $70,000 to $100,000 into that home, you know, three bedroom, two bath home, let's just say, you know, basically you put $100,000 into that home, the equity that you get just right off the bat from that is another maybe $50,000 or so. I'm gonna guess, you know, $30,000 to $50,000 off the bat. I mean, you've enriched that family by $30,000 to $50,000. You know, and I don't know what it is about us that doesn't really, you know, it doesn't really click for us that we should do that to build wealth within communities of color. And to me, I mean, it's a simple way of doing it. But, you know, you look at it, I mean, the two problems are going to be simple. One is the problem of access to capital to rehab the place. You know, two is, well, people of color generally don't have the skills to fix up a place and all that stuff. And so we're worried that maybe they don't know what they're doing. But, I mean, I think those...
That's not true.
Right. Yeah. No, we're working on perceptions now. I mean, I think the reality is, you know, it's a little bit different than that. But I think those are the things that we need to work towards, you know, solving. Because if we can do that, we're going to, you know, create wealth for people of color in this community. And those are the folks who are in most need. Those are the folks that are the most numerous up here on the north side. And that's the thing, is that, I mean, I want us to move to finding solutions that can help people of color, because really, I mean, at the end, that's going to help all of North Minneapolis. And, you know, people can say all these things about, like, we all do better when we all do better, or, you know, where North Minneapolis goes, so goes the city. Well, then let's do something about it.
I'm Al McFarlane. You're listening to Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest is Blong Yang, 5th Ward City Council member. We'll be back in a minute. I'm Al McFarlane. This is Conversations with Al McFarlane. I continue with Blong Yang, 5th Ward City Council member. Blong, thank you again for being here, first of all.
Thanks for having me.
Let's tell your story. I haven't had a chance to talk to you about your path to this position. And I'd like to hear you describe kind of what set you on your path to public service. I know you're a lawyer.
Yes.
And I think, I don't know if you were born here or...
No, I wasn't.
You're not, you're an immigrant then, right?
Right.
Tell me the story.
Yeah, well, you know, my family came to the U.S. in 1980 because of what happened, you know, prior to 1975 in terms of the Vietnam War and what happened in Laos. And, you know, my family was in the camps for 5 years. I was born a year after the fall of Vietnam and Laos. And we came here, you know, 3.5 years later in 1980. And
the family had been in Vietnam, though?
In Laos.
In Laos, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And so we became refugees into Thailand and eventually came to the States from the refugee camps in Thailand. And, you know, we came to Oklahoma. And so I was an Okie for about 3 years.
How old were you when you came here?
I was about almost four.
Okay.
And, you know, I was there for, you know, about 3 years. And then my family decided to do the secondary migration to Merced, California, which is Central Valley area of California, about 50 miles north of Fresno. And, you know, a small little town of 60,000, one high school. And, you know, I grew up there. So that's my hometown. I lived there from about 84 to 94. And then I went to college at UCLA. Mm-hmm. And in 1995, we actually won a national championship in basketball. So that was our 11th.
And you played?
No. I got no skills. But, you know, we I did that, and then I came to law school up here in Minnesota. You know, it wasn't my first choice, but you know, it was a great opportunity, and they offered me a nice scholarship, and you know, I came up here, and I can't say I fell in love with it. I mean, it was just, it was cold. I mean, I felt like the first January, I mean, I wanted to shoot myself. It's on TV now, but you know, the thing about Minnesota that was amazing though was that when it was spring and summer, I mean, it was just amazing. You know, it was beautiful. I mean, all the lakes around Minneapolis and St. Paul, I mean, all those sorts of things, I mean, just make you fall in love with it. And you know, I did law school for 3 years, graduated, and then I started with the Legal Aid Society of Minneapolis on the north side here. And that's when I moved up to the north side in 2001. And I lived on 26th and Logan, and then eventually I bought a house on 27th and Logan. And you know, for me, I mean, living up on the north side, you know, what really got me was, you know, after several years living here, my wife and I had experienced crime that happened, you know, onto us, whether it was, you know, my back door getting kicked in three times, or my car windows getting shot. I mean, those sorts of things. And you know, it got to the point where I just realized, you know what? Look, I mean, you either fight or you flight. You know, our flight probably would have been to go to St. Paul, where everybody else was that looked like us, right? And you know, I think, I mean, eventually it just got to a point where I just felt like, you know, it was either one or the other, and I decided just to fight. And you know, in 2012, the county commissioner's seat of District 2 opened up, and you know, I was a nobody. I mean, nobody knew who the heck I was. And you know, this Hmong guy from like North Minneapolis, who nobody knows, just, you know, decided to run. And you know, I mean, there was a slate of about 10 candidates. One of the candidates was Linda Higgins, who was a state senator 16 years prior to, and then, or for the past 16 years, let me say, and then Don Samuels was a candidate, and eventually he dropped out. But you know, I just put my name in there, and somehow, I mean, I worked my butt off to, you know, finish second, and so I went head-to-head with Linda Higgins for that seat, and you know, I lost. And you know, I mean, I think I lost by a margin that was fairly respectable for a nobody. You know, it was a 60-40 split, and people were just like, what just happened? And
you learned a lot, right?
Oh, absolutely.
So what did you learn? What went into the computer at that point in time from that experience?
You know, I think, I mean, a couple of things. I mean, one thing was, you know, when you looked at the numbers for Commissioner Higgins versus myself in Ward 5, you know, it was a different split. It was a 52-46 split. And so for somebody who's a nobody who did that sort of number, I mean, it makes you feel like, wow, I mean, I have a shot somewhere here in Ward 5. You know, I wasn't thinking about the city council race then, but I mean, I did better than even the average.
That's where the numbers were.
Right,
the numbers
right.
Revealed themselves to you.
Right, so that was one. I think two is, you know, when you do it the first time, you're so lost. You don't know what you're doing. I mean, you're not a good candidate. You don't really know how to spend money. You know, I think the second time around, I mean, I knew exactly what to spend my money on. I knew exactly how to run my campaign. I knew what to do. It was much more efficient. You know, it was, you know, District 2 was huge. I mean, it was 165,000 people. I mean, Ward 5, about 30,000 people. It was so much more manageable and or so much easier in terms of the area location and, you know, the size and the population and that sort of thing. So, I mean, it just made it that much easier. But, I mean, the most important part was just having that experience and knowing how to spend money the second time around. It made it so much easier.
The critical thing was that there wasn't an endorsement, right?
Right. There wasn't an endorsement.
How did that figure into the outcomes?
You know, I don't...
So the deal is, in North Minneapolis and in the city, DFL endorsement is tantamount to election. That's the phrase you hear.
Right,
and it's relatively true.
Right.
And so it's significant that there wasn't an endorsement. We also had proportional voting, I think, and that may have been a factor here.
Ranked choice voting.
Yeah. So tell me...
You know, I'll tell you, I mean, against conventional wisdom, I think even if I didn't get the endorsement, I probably would have won. Maybe that's my overconfidence, but I felt strongly that we would have run, you know, a really good campaign to win despite the endorsement. You know, as a DFLer, I've never received an endorsement before in the two races, so you know, I don't know what the benefits are necessarily, you know, specific to me, but I mean, I will work towards that in the future.
Sure.
You know, I think ranked choice voting, in my view, up on in the fifth ward, didn't play a huge role. You know, if you looked at the numbers, you know, flat out, I mean, you know, the person who got the most votes eventually, you know, when it went to second or third ballots, I mean, still you know, one. And, you know, I thought that was really telling, because I think when people look at those numbers, I mean, what they tend to think is, you know, Blong just won with all these Hmong votes. But, Al, the Hmong votes up here don't get you elected. I mean, they get you close. But, you know, when you look at the split for the second and third ballots, what you saw was that, you know, the African-American community put me in office. You know, and I think, I mean, that's something that, you know, I'm always mindful about, because I feel like I'm here not only to represent Hmong folks, to represent everybody.
The perception may be that the split involved a solid Hmong vote and white vote.
Right.
And not the African Americans, though I know that there were significant numbers of well-known and highly visible African Americans supporting you aggressively.
Right.
But there's this perception that it was the black community losing out with a coalition of Hmong and white. Does that make sense or not?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think that's the conventional wisdom. I would tend to disagree with that. And when I look at that, I mean, you know, you could say that, let's say, with like the first choice votes, but, you know, I mean, I think, in my view, I mean, a lot of the white votes, you know, were lost in the first choice votes. I mean, when you get to the second choice, third choice votes, you know, those are the votes from Kale and Brett Buckner, Kale Severs and Brett Buckner. I mean, those votes, I would say, you know, I mean, on average, were much more African-American votes. And I mean, when you look at the split between Ian and myself with regards to those votes, I mean, it went, you know, about half and half. I mean, I think I got a majority versus Ian, but it was pretty close. And so, I mean, when you look at that, I mean, to me, it speaks to, you know, African Americans putting their votes behind me as well. And, you know, I would say, you know, we went into the election knowing that, you know, we had to create a new electorate. You know, and in 2009, the votes were such that, you know, there were about 2,300 votes. In 2013, we increased that by 50%. The whole candidate slate. I mean, there were about 3,600 votes. I mean, it was a 50% increase. And of that, I mean, I'm going to take some credit for it. I felt like we created, you know, a new electorate, and it was a new electorate, you know, what I would call, let's say, an immigrant bloc, where, you know, there were Hmong voters, there were Somali voters, there were Lao voters, there were other voters that added to the mix as well. And I think, I mean, you know, people tend to stick with the black and white paradigm, but I mean, we created a different paradigm on top of it.
Yeah. Okay. What's the future hold for you?
I have to tell you, I mean, the life of an elected official is, it's what the people here want, right? I mean, it's
one election at a time, right?
Yes. Yes. You know, I mean, I will run again. You know, I would love to be unopposed. I mean, that never happens up here. They're always exciting and looking forward to it. But, you know, it's, you know, I feel like I want to do good work. I continue to want to do good work. And I, you know, I tell folks, you know, the measure of my success is not how Hmong people did in the 4 years that I've served or in my time. The measure of my success is how African Americans have done in my time in office. And, you know, I hope people would measure me on that. And I feel like we've done some really good things that have benefited a lot of people, but I mean, specifically African Americans.
How's your family feel? How's your family life?
You know, my kids are young enough that this is exciting. You know, when they see me on stage, they want to join me on stage. It's fun. And, you know, that's because, you know, they're 8 and, you know, almost 6. Mm-hmm. My wife probably loses hair, you know, gets gray hairs more than I do. It's tough. You know, it's tough because, you know, I think, I mean, generally some people are really harsh. Mm-hmm. It gets very personal. You know, sometimes you lose friends over, you know, small things, over some big things, and those sorts of things. And, you know, nobody really measures you, you know, on your overall vote. They just measure you on one specific thing, and sometimes that's really difficult. And, you know, I think the spouses get it the worst.
What do you do for fun?
What do I
do for fun?
Oh, gosh.
What are your hobbies?
You know, in the summertime,
hunting, fishing, bicycling, baseball, basketball. What do you do?
You know, in the summer, I love to go fishing.
Okay.
It takes me away from things. Mm-hmm. You know, I also like to just, you know, travel with my family, just to go on big long road trips and just kind of enjoy. I mean, the great wide open that's America.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fifth Ward, North Minneapolis, is a beautiful place. I think we don't spend enough time talking about the amenity exists. Innocent around us. I got involved in the Major Taylor Bicycling Club, and one of the stories that was compelling and inviting from them was that we're so used to jumping in our car and driving from here 2 blocks to the grocery store or whatever.
Right.
We don't walk enough, and we don't bicycle enough, and there are so many trails and so many parts of our community that can be seen best from the pedestrian level or from bicycling. How do we promote the beauty of our community differently so that our people, number one, remember that this is really a marvelous community, and then have a sense of equity and ownership so that the pride compels the utilization and the engagement and the support of the continued development of our environment and our community? What do you think?
You know, I think a lot of things that relate to North Minneapolis are perceptions, and they're usually negative perceptions. And, you know, to your point, I mean, I think we have to start talking about it positively. We have to talk about it in terms of amenities that are rich, not, you know, deficit amenities up here. And I think that's the part that, you know, is missing in the conversation of everybody up on the north side. I mean, you know, you look at like places that are on Facebook where there are groups. I mean, people talk about just North Minneapolis like it's a dump, and people talk about the crime and they're focused on all that stuff. But you are absolutely right. I mean, the greatness up here is our rich history. It's our people. It's the amazing things that are up here that people have just kind of ignored or forgotten. And, you know, we need to start talking about those things a lot more. You know, you look at the housing up here, I mean, it is spectacular. Yeah. The housing stock is fantastic. Most folks, you know, I mean, I'll tell you, like, when I was on the campaign trail, I had friends who didn't live here. They showed up here to help, and, you know, they took walks with me, and they're like, oh, my God, I can't believe you guys have houses like this. I mean, all I thought about when I thought about North Minneapolis is, like, a ghetto. And it's like, no, I mean, these are amazing, you know, houses that we have up here. There's a lot of amazing things up here.
Well, even the Plymouth Avenue townhomes, I knew the gentleman that built those properties, and I've always driven from my house there to my office here on Bryant Avenue. That's my daily ride four or five times a day. But I've always said Plymouth Avenue is a beautiful street.
Right.
And those townhomes, when they're maintained, and they have been,
right,
I think, very well maintained. And sometimes the summers, I see the either the association or the residents doing things to make it a very attractive and inviting community.
Right.
I think we don't pay attention to that enough, and we don't celebrate and applaud that enough. But I think we ought to. I love the fact that we have the new development, the old Holman development.
Heritage Park.
Heritage Park, you know, the new YMCA down there. We've got great things going on here. How do we keep that energy out front?
Well, you know, so speaking of the Plymouth Townhomes, I mean, they received some money from the Affordable Housing Trust Fund to do rehabilitation work on them. And, you know, they have not been rehabbed in about 40 years. And so they're going to get a makeover at some point. And, you know, I think, I mean, let me just say that, you know, to folks who are fearful that the residents are going to be displaced, I mean, my understanding is that that's not going to be the case. It's going to be a slow rehab that is going to go over time, but eventually, I mean, it's going to get these units to become newer units. So I think that's one thing. I mean, in terms of all the things that are happening up here, I mean, I think, you know, there is a lot of energy that's happening. You know, you look at Devin Jordan's project on Golden Valley and Penn, you know, building blocks. You look at Dean Rose's project on Broadway Flats. You know, I think eventually he's going to move across the street to where his old liquor store is and, you know, do a development there, hopefully.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are a number of different things that are happening. You know, Broadway Curve, Broadway Crescent that's happening in terms of housing and townhomes, you know, along West Broadway. There are a lot of opportunities. And I think that's the part about, you know, our North Minneapolis that is going to look different, you know, in the next decade or so. And I mean, I want you to be a part of it. I want everybody in North Minneapolis to be a part of it, because if we're not, somebody else is.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so it's ours. We need to, you know, take ownership of it. We need to move those things forward. And, you know, if we can do that in such a way that it brings opportunities to the folks who live up here, who have the talents that can do that sort of work, I mean, we need to slowly move that dial and get folks to be a part of it.
How do we redefine North Minneapolis? Do you see that as part of the mission, creating a public identity that's different or that's enhanced? What do you think?
You know, I'm not so...
Is that something you can do, or do you wait and watch it happen on its own volition?
You know, I think, I mean, we can have plans for how it should look, and we should, you know, we can, like, try to adhere to the plan. But, I mean, in terms of, like, rebranding North Minneapolis, you know, I feel like we are at a good place, and we will continue to be at a good place. We've been at a good place for a long time. We just need to start doing stuff.
Transportation. What's going to happen with the light rail?
You know, light rail is going to get built, the Botno line at least, you know, on Highway 55 up to Golden Valley and to the Brooklands. You know, it's a process that could probably take another, 5 years to 10 years. you know, sometimes, you know, it's just the issues related to, you know, the costs. I mean, you know, initially, I think Botno was slated to be about $1 billion. Now, I mean, the cost estimates have gone up $500 million more, so to $1.5 billion. Southwest eventually will get built as well. And so, I mean, a lot of things are happening. It's just, you know, to me, when I look at light rail, though, I mean, what I see is that it's going to cut through a neighborhood, and it's going to, I mean, Harrison's going to be kind of like an island, right, where light rail cuts it from the top and the bottom. And so, you know, it's going to see some changes, pretty drastic. But, I mean, I think the rest of North Minneapolis, which is from Highway 55 all the way up to 53rd, I mean, what about that? I mean, that's a big question.
Mm-hmm. And so the system ought to figure out how we connect and use transit to bring economic development. How do you see that happening?
Well, you know, there's discussion of a streetcar running through Broadway. I mean, there also are discussions about BRT routes. You know, I know that BRT is going to run through Penn Avenue. I think eventually it'll go through Emerson, Fremont. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I mean, we should be thinking about whether BRT, you know, is a better mode than, you know, streetcar on West Broadway or Lowry or Dowling or any number of, you know, these nodes in North Minneapolis. And those are the things that are really going to change how North Minneapolis looks and feels. But I mean, I think there are a lot of investments that are out there. It's just that we need to be a part of the conversation to direct how that works. You know, let me talk briefly about, you know, Upper Harbor Terminal. I mean, you know, it's there. I mean, there's a huge opportunity there for 50 acres that is owned by us.
So Bill English and his friends are trying to produce an industrial park,
right,
not up there, but closer to down here.
Right.
How does the city help them or move that? You know, the background is that he's identified, I think, three or four companies that are up and running and doing multiple millions in business that want to bring their businesses to North Minneapolis. And these are black-owned companies. How do we facilitate and ensure that that can happen?
Right. Well, you know, with Upper Harbor Terminal, I mean, there's about 50 acres. You know, there's going to be a split between parks and the city. And, you know, with the city, I mean, it's going to be some sort of development that probably is going to be residential, light industrial, commercial of some sort. You know, at this point, I mean, you know, it's a big idea, and we're waiting on folks to, you know, give us ideas about how they're going to develop it. You know, with regards to Bill English and the Northside Jobs Creation Team, basically, you know, Bill has this idea for a business park that is going to be in the Harrison neighborhood, you know, contain, let me tell you the parameters, West Broadway, Lindale, up to maybe about 24th or 26th. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, we're in discussions to talk about it, mm-hmm. but I mean, there's nothing real concrete at this point, because you would have to take out so many homes.
Yeah.
That would be pretty insane, and I think that's the part where, you know, we gotta figure out what makes sense. I mean, the costs on that, we don't even know what the costs are, but I mean, my guess is the costs are gonna be anywhere from 50 million plus, basically. And so, you know, we have to just weigh what's good and what's the cost.
We're out of time.
Yes.
I got about a minute.
Yes.
You know, give a parting comment to the community, your expectation, your hope for Fifth Ward.
You know, it's been my honor to represent Ward 5 for the last 2 years. You know, hopefully, you know, I will get that opportunity again. But, you know, I think the people are the ones that get to speak on that. And, you know, for me, I mean, I feel like we are moving in really good directions to get to a place where we are creating jobs on the north side, we're creating businesses on the north side, we are, you know, creating housing opportunities for people on the north side, whether it's affordable housing or getting people into home ownership. You know, a lot of these things are not sexy things, they're things that happen maybe a little bit more behind the scenes than I'd like, but I mean, we're moving in the right places, and, you know, I feel like I am doing everything I can to work really hard for the folks here, because, you know, the folks here deserve it more than anywhere else. They deserve a lot of, you know, strong advocacy to get us to a place where, you know, we need to be.
Blong Yang, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm Al McFarlane. You're listening to Conversations with Al McFarlane. My guest, Blong Yang, 5th Ward City Council member. Join us again next time. Thank you.
Programming is supported by UCARE, where health coverage, personal service, and quality care come together to put members first. Learn more at ucare.org. UCARE, healthcare that starts with you.
Be up, be down, be clean, be messy, be here. Be wherever. Be sour. Be sweet. Be the rhythm. Be the beat. Be funny. Be serious. Be in. Be out. Wherever you're at in life, be you. With Medica, you belong.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We got to say good night. We want to thank Al McFarlane for bringing us all those great words and all our lovely guests, all the guests in the house. Everything's good, you know. So I want y'all to tune in every Tuesday morning, right around 9 o'clock. Because we're going to play a song. All the guests will be home. We'll be feeling like talking. Have a robust conversation. Because this thing is safe. The message is clear. Everybody knows we got to give it life clear.